Hello, my name's Kevin Graham and welcome to Celtic State of Mind. To my left today we've got Paul John Dykes.
Hello.
And our guest today doing the soundtrack of his Celtic life is Celtic View Editor Paul Cuddihy.
How are you doing?
Welcome to the show, Paul.
Thanks very much for having me. I'm looking forward to this.
As are we. We know you're a big music fan. You've written a book about your musical tastes. You play the guitar yourself, of course.
Yes.
So we thought you were an ideal candidate for the soundtrack to your Celtic life. You know the format because JP Taylor might have told you that he has had the biggest hit in podcast for a Celtic State of Mind.
I think he's mentioned it
he's
once or twice.
Mentioned
yeah.
It. The is most it? Popular show, JP.
I think there's a bit of competition now, ain't there?
Well, over to you, Paul. Over to you. So what we're trying to do is look at seven pivotal moments from your Celtic supporting career and the song that takes you back to that moment. So we'll start off with your first Celtic memory.
Yeah, it was difficult. Actually, the music was a lot harder than the Celtic memories, trying to tie them in. So the first memory, or the first one that I've chosen, was actually 1974, the Atletico Madrid home tie. The 0-0 game, the infamous game when they'd eight men booked, three sent off. And I'd started going to games a couple of years before then with my dad. But, you know, I have sort of vague memories, just like wee snippets of, you know, going to Hampden for the 72 Cup final, everything all in green. You know, just tiny wee memories. But that game, so I was about seven at the time. That game, it remains as vivid to me to this day as it was back then, just because I don't think I've ever seen anything as shocking. Obviously, I hadn't at the time. I'm not sure if I've ever seen anything as shocking in a football field ever since. And, you know, obviously, you've seen footage of some of the assaults on the Celtic players, and it was something that just, it remained with me. And I actually was speaking to my dad before doing this podcast. You know, his memory, what he said was that he thought the Celtic support that night showed incredible restraint, given what they were witnessing. You know, a European Cup semi-final. And if it had all been about football, we'd have been in the final. And I think Atletico Madrid realised that. You know, they didn't play their first team. They just played guys that they knew they could sacrifice for the second leg. So they were just intent on kicking us off the park. And that just, as I say, that was so shocking and it remains so vivid. That would probably be my earliest, most vivid memory of Celtic.
When you've got a memory as vivid and shocking as that, Paul, and then you, years and years later, are perhaps interviewing certain players who were involved, Pat McCluskey, Davy Hay. Have you ever had an insight into what happened in the tunnel when they all had the big fallout? I think it was at halftime.
Not really, no. They've not really. Nobody's really. I don't think they've ever gone into too much details. I mean, I think it's one of those things. It's like everything else in football. It's the great what ifs of, you know, as I say, I think everything else being equal, we would have been in the final. I mean, Atletico Madrid came within about 60 seconds of winning the European Cup. I think Bayern Munich equalised in the last minute, and then they won the replay. So I keep thinking, and again, when I was thinking about, you know, what I was going to say here, and I'm, you know, that could have been our chance, you know, for a second European Cup win. So it was really frustrating. And I always remember my parents were both teachers, and so like we were never allowed to stay up late on a school night. We were always, you know, I had to go to bed early. But I always remember, apart from the fact going to the game that night, when I came home, I think my dad and I were both so shocked with what we were seeing, I was actually allowed to stay up and watch it on the TV again, which just never happened in our house. And then, you know, going to school the next day.
They definitely singled out wee Jinky for the roughhouse tactics. I remember there was a picture after the game, maybe during the week, and it showed you on his bare legs with the bruises and the cuts. It was unbelievable. As you say, some of them were assaults, never mind bad tackles.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was four or five Argentinians they drafted in as part of the squad who weren't regular first-team players, so they knew what they were going to do. So they should have been thrown out the tournament, you know, simple as that.
And being a football fan and rational, we still didn't like Atletico Madrid because of that.
That's right. There's a few teams that are in that bracket and they're definitely one.
Yeah, they're right up there. Yeah.
Rapid Vienna's the other one.
And the Racing Club.
Porto. Well, I don't know about Porto. Mayor Jose Mourinho.
Yeah, it's a long time ago, but I've still never forgiven Atletico Madrid for that. I never will.
I wasn't born.
and you haven't forgiven them?
No, I haven't forgiven them, no.
Now, when you think back to that then, how did you go about choosing a song that takes you back to that period, Paul?
I mean, this was probably one of the easier ones. I think, as you know, some of the later memories, I wasn't always listening to the same music of that time, so I've had to try and think of what triggered it. But at that time, 1974. As I say, my parents were both teachers, so our summer holidays were long holidays. We always either went up north of Scotland, or we went down south, but it was 3 or 4 weeks because my mum and dad were off. So that's the summer of 74. We went with my mum and dad's friends, their family, and we went touring around the north of Scotland for about 3 or 4 weeks, and I just remember it being a great holiday. My best pal, he was there, and it was just great. And one of the artists that my mum and dad had a cassette tape of, The Carpenters, and that always seemed to be on in the car. There was probably other things as well, but that's always the one that stuck in my mind. So that always reminds me of childhood. I mean, I absolutely love The Carpenters. I love Karen Carpenter's voice. And so that sort of music takes me back to just being a wee guy in those sort of long summer holidays of that particular year of 1974. And the song, I mean, there's so many good Carpenter songs for me, but I think it was Only Yesterday it was the one that I chose, and I just think it's a wonderful song.
The thing about The Carpenters, you mentioned Karen Carpenter's voice. When you hear The Carpenters, you know it's them. Sometimes you hear other bands, you hear a song on the radio and you could go, well, that could be 3 or 4 bands. But her voice and the drumming, well, especially on that record, the drumming on Only Yesterday, it's sort of not out of time, but it's quite jerky. It suits the song. It really does suit the song.
And I always remember one of the songs it was always another favourite of mine, was actually the cover version they did, A Ticket to Ride.
That's right.
And the guy I work with at the Celtic View, Joe Sullivan, who's been there for years and years and years, and he's a massive music, I mean, he really is a massive music fan, and he's a massive Beatles fan. And when I was a wee guy, I always thought Ticket to Ride was a Carpenter song. And it was only later I discovered it was obviously the Beatles. And I made the mistake of telling Joe this, much to his disgust, of my level of ignorance. The Beatles version's obviously better, but the Carpenters did a decent version too.
After long enough of being alone, everyone must face their share of loneliness. In my own time, waiting was all my heart could do. Hope was all I had until you came. Maybe you can't see how much you mean to me. You were the dawn breaking the night, the promise of morning light.
Showed me the way to leave.
football. And what's your second Celtic memory?
What kind of jumps forward from then to 1986 and Love Street? And again, it's, you know, that way when you say pick seven memories, and probably everybody that's done it, as soon as you pick seven, you could pick another seven and another seven. So, but the reason I picked Love Street, and by that time I had left school and I was working, it used to be a shop called Olympus Sport, it was in Argyll Street. So I used to work there full time. And so as a result, most Saturdays I was working, and you would only get off very rarely for occasional games. So most of the time I didn't get to see the games because I was having to work. And what you used to be able to do was, back in the day, if you dialed 261, you would get Radio Clyde commentary on the phone. So more often than not, on a Saturday afternoon, if somebody came up to the first floor in Olympus Sport, I'd be standing on the phone pretending to be on an order, but actually I just dialed 261 just to listen to the commentary. So the reason I chose Love Street is, the night before the game, one of my friends, the two of us went up to Strathclyde Uni, Level 8, and I don't know why we decided to do this, but the bar, you know, all the optics behind the bar, we just decided, because the drink was obviously cheap, we just thought, we'll start at the left and we'll end on the right, and we just did doubles of everything, so we just walked away all the way along. So needless to say, we were quite drunk. So the next day, he was going to Love Street, I was having to go to work, so I had to get in, start at 9 o'clock. So within about 10 minutes of starting, I realised I was in trouble, because every time, if a customer came in and I came up to say, can I help you at all, I could barely get the words out, and I thought, I'm going to throw up here. So after about an hour, the assistant manager, who happened to be a Rangers fan, I think he realised, and he decided to send me home. And I think part of it probably thought, he's at it because he wants to go to the game, but I genuinely couldn't, I was so ill. So I went home, went straight to my bed, and then I woke up about 5 minutes before the end of the game and just turned the radio on right away. And you know that way, probably at the start of the day, there's that hope that something might have happened, but actually, I think most people genuinely would have thought, you know, it's hard to see Hearts losing. Turn on the radio, and lo and behold, Hearts are losing 2-0 and we're going to win the league. So I'm jumping about the room thinking this is absolutely amazing. My pal, meanwhile, who had been out with me the night before, I don't think he'd missed a game that season, and he was walking down, we stayed in Bishop Briggs, so he was walking down to get the bus, supporters bus, got halfway down, had to throw up and went home because he thought, I'm so ill and I don't think we're going to do it. So he actually, I think it was about the only game he missed that season, and he was absolutely, I mean, I think he never quite forgave himself for that.
That's interesting, because JP missed that game, didn't he?
He did, aye.
So he's working at Ladbrokes, you're about throwing up at Olympus Sport, and the both of you missed the game.
If I hadn't not been well, I'd had to work. As I say, I was, they would occasionally let you off for cup finals, or if you knew far enough in advance, but most times we were all full time staff, so you were always expected. Saturday was just part of your working week, so but it was still great, you know, waking up 5 minutes before the end of the game. So we headed back out on Saturday night again.
So am I the only person in this room that was at that game?
I wasn't at Love Street.
The only reason I was taken to that game was because my dad didn't believe that we were going to win the league. And he just says, I'll take you to an away game. And my memory of that game is pestering them to get on the park after we had won, eh? And we're soaking, absolutely soaking. Mm-hmm. I had a 1980 replica top on, and it was the cotton material, and it was absolutely drenched.
I don't know if that game as well, I mean, that's one of the best away kits that we've had. And obviously part of it is because it's associated with that game as well, but it's just such an iconic strip as well. And then just everything about the day, obviously, you know, for people who were there, it's just something special. But for everyone else, you see some of the goals we scored. Then just even the fact that, you know, and the St Mirren keeper's got the ball and suddenly everybody's found out what the score is from Dens Park. And what I like about that as well is because it's the olden days where everybody had to listen, you know, all the games were on at the same time, so and then you were listening to the tranny just waiting for the other results, and that's, you know, that doesn't really happen a lot nowadays. So even now, every now and again, when there's games on and suddenly there's a cheer goes up for no other reason and something's happened elsewhere, I like that because it kind of takes you back to those days.
There's a guy in front of me at Celtic Park still has got a radio, and I think that's brilliant. Everybody else is on their phones checking their betting apps or Sky Sports, and this guy has still got a radio.
That is real old school.
Any time I see it, I get a wee warm glow in my stomach. The goals at Love Street that day, classic Celtic goals.
That passing movement down the right between McGray and McStay, that was just incredible.
I know, there's just a wee tiny bit of you, just if only somebody else had scored it.
That's right, because it's McClare that plays it in, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Aye, and he who shall not be named puts the ball in. So I think it's also funny that somebody like Albert Kidd has become part of Celtic folklore, because he was at the 30th anniversary dance at Celtic Park, wasn't he?
Yeah, I love that. I think, I mean, obviously he was a big Celtic fan as well, and if you look at that, I mean, that Dundee team had a mixture of real Celtic fans and some big Rangers fans in it as well. John Brown was a part of that team as well, so they did what they had to do. And I mean, again, some of those great moments and some images of that day of, you know, the Hearts fans desolate on the terrace, and I mean, that does bring a smile to your face as well.
So, Paul, what's your song and what made you choose this song?
The song is The Smiths, What Difference Does It Make? And again, I don't think that necessarily the year ties up with it, but what The Smiths and what that song reminds me of is Level 8 at Strathclyde University. So I just love The Smiths. I guess one of my real musical regrets, I never went to see them at the time. I don't know why, you know, that way you think back, I can't think of any reason why I wouldn't have gone, but I always wish I had had seen them. Some of the guys at school had gone to see them at the Barrowlands, and I just wish I had gone. But that kind of music, I just remember, it reminds me of going up to Level 8 at Strathclyde Uni. I wasn't there at uni, but quite a few of my pals were, so it was always Thursday, Friday, Saturday night, we were generally there. So that kind of music reminds me, and obviously that's where I'd been the night before Love Street. And I still think What Difference Does It Make is one of the best, you know, it's one of my favourite songs, I just love it.
One of the best guitar intros ever.
For another Celtic-minded man, Johnny Marr, what's your take, Paul, on a band like The Smiths and previously The Stone Roses? What's your take on these great bands reforming? Should they just leave it?
Well, I mean, obviously The Smiths are never going to reform, and there's something really, you know, it's...
I think Morrissey's blown out.
Yeah, it's slightly... I was speaking to a friend of mine who's a Smiths fan as well, and it's like everybody feels kind of uncomfortable about the political route he's gone down. I'm not sure. I think sometimes you can be a bit cynical and say that sometimes bands, you know, they're obviously reforming because they see that there's, you know, there's money to be made in nostalgia and coming back again, and they'll play, you know, a lot of big venues, big gigs, and make some money. But at the same time, I don't think there's anything wrong with nostalgia. A lot of the bands that I like from, say, back in the 80s when I was growing up, I still like going to see them now, because I think there's something about almost reliving your youth. The songs that you hear now from bands that you remember, it takes you back to when you were a teenager, and I like that. So I have no problem, because at the end of the day, if a band reforms, if people want to go and see them, then they'll sell out. If they don't, then obviously they've realised that those days are past. So I think it's fine. I'm okay with it.
Johnny Marr's kind of gone through a wee bit of a career boost with his new solo album as well, Call the Comet.
Is that maybe why he's not returning my emails for this
maybe
podcast?
He's maybe quite busy, Paul. Eh? Mm-hmm.
Would you know, his book, never a massive fan of autobiographies. I think just the whole nature of them, quite often it's quite self-centred, and that gets a bit tiresome. But I thought his book was fascinating, partly because you knew you were talking about the intro to What Difference Does It Make. He goes in, a lot of it's over my head in terms of musicianship, but he's into quite a lot of detail of what they did and how they recorded it, and it's quite fascinating when you think how he's broken that down. So obviously he starts with just the music, Morrissey's lyrics, but then he explains almost like the kind of production of it, which is actually fascinating, and it was a really good book, actually.
It is a good book, I've read it.
I would recommend, talking about reformations, the Pixies documentary. Is it Loud, Quiet, Loud, I think it's called? And it just shows you how you can get these people who, 20 years ago, there was a chemistry in the room, and you can place them back in a room and the chemistry's gone, and it's just four individuals, you know. Although they still were very successful, sold out, great shows, but the chemistry was away. And it's actually quite difficult to watch. About three quarters of the way through it, you think, wow, they're just doing it for the money, they were all skint, you know. So I would recommend that as a documentary.
Sometimes that's better, when you actually see a warts and all, and they don't make any attempt to hide that it's not there anymore. Eh?
That's where I think they're obviously, as you say, they're reforming, because they see that there's money to be made.
Mm-hmm.
And that's always a short-term thing, because if there's animosity, then it will quickly resurface.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. What you usually find with bands reforming, it usually comes after a divorce.
Ian Brown, you're right. Ian Brown split off his wife, the Roses, reformed.
Happy Mondays as well. Sean mm-hmm. Ryder had mm-hmm. to pay a tax bill and got divorced.
I think no amount of divorces are going to get the Smiths back now, but...
secrets and here is mine, so let it be known. For we have been through hell and high tide. I think I can rely on you. And yet you start to recoil. Heavy words are so lightly thrown, but still I leap in front of a flying bullet for you. So what difference does it make? So what difference does it make? I've gone, and you must be looking very old tonight. The devil will find work for idle hands to do. I stole and I lied, and why? Because you asked me to. But now you make me feel so ashamed, because I've only got two hands. But I'm still fond of you. Oh, oh, oh. So what difference does it make? Oh, what difference does it make? Oh, it makes none, but now you have gone, and your prejudice won't keep you warm tonight. Oh, the devil will find work for idle hands to do. I stole and then I lied, just because you asked me to. But now you know the truth about me, you won't see me anymore. Well, I'm still fond of you, oh, oh, oh. But no more apologies.
Memory number three is just 2 years on from Love Street, and I think probably everyone of my age would choose the Centenary Cup final. It remains the perfect day for me. I don't think I've had a better day as a Celtic fan than that day that we won the cup. Just from the moment we woke up, when I woke up, to the moment whenever I eventually crashed out, it was just everything about it was perfect. That it was the culmination of, you know, that whole, the fairy tale of Celtic and that whole season, and it was kind of written in the stars that we were going to win. And I just loved that whole day. I went with a couple of my pals. We'd gone all every week at that time, and we'd actually get the bus into High Street. I think originally we were just going to walk from High Street out to Hampden, and a car stopped us just at the station at High Street, and it was two Dundee United fans who weren't sure how to get to Hampden, because obviously they weren't really regular visitors to Hampden, and gave us a list. There was three guys in Celtic tops, and even then I thought, what an incredible level of trust that they just, the three of us jumped in the back, directed them, and they dropped us off at our end. We told them where to go, and it was brilliant. It was like that was a perfect start to the day. You know, the sun was scorching, and even when we went a goal down, I don't think anybody thought we were going to lose. We obviously won with the late goal. And then after the game, we headed back into town, and a couple of the guys had tickets for the Celtic Story at the Pavilion that night. And I think just with the sort of crush at the front door, a few of the rest of us managed to sneak in, saw the show, you know, the team came on with the trophy, and that's absolutely brilliant. And then at the end of the night, one of my pals, his parents were having a party. So that's where we were heading back to Bishop Briggs. And it was, by the time we get back, it was maybe about 11:30, 12. And it was as if we were greeted like returning heroes. When we walked in, it was as if we had won the cup. And it was like, oh, just because we'd been at the game. And it was just then the party went on all night. And it literally was just a perfect day.
And is your song of the era, or is it a song that has become relevant since then, Paul?
Well, the reason I chose, it's called The Unforgettable Fire by U2. And the reason I chose that was right at the start of the centenary season, we played Arsenal in a friendly, and they beat us 5-1. And U2 were playing Murrayfield that day. So me and my pal had tickets to go and see U2. So I'd stayed at his house the night before, and again, we had a bit of a party. So then the next morning, I was just lying in his couch, and he put that song on, just turned it up full blast. So the start of that song, it always reminds me of that day. And then we went through to Murrayfield and watched the gig, find out that Celtic got absolutely hammered, and thinking, it doesn't augur well for the season. But obviously things turned out well. But so that song reminds me just of the start of that whole centenary season.
It's U2 at their 80s best, eh? It's epic, it's sparse.
Musical, but no fashion. I mean, Bono's hair had left a lot to be desired.
Musically, eh? There's plenty of bands try to sound like that era U2 and failed miserably.
I must say, I actually preferred Act Two and Baby era.
Well, that's when you actually think about it, being a music fan round about that time, it wasn't until Act Two and Baby that I went back and looked at U2, mm-hmm. because they were very easy to ridicule in the 80s, growing up, just because of Bono.
You know, the two albums I were listening to in the studio when they recorded Act Two and Baby? Pills and Thrills and Bellyaches and the Stone Roses. That was the two albums that they played constantly during these sessions.
See, I kind of liked them from I Will Follow. I just thought that was mm-hmm. a brilliant song. And then obviously when they started to kind of break through Sunday Bloody Sunday, things like that, and then Unforgettable Fire, and then the Joshua Tree. So I loved all that. I thought that, you know, I kind of, to an extent, I've always, you can just set aside the irritation mm-hmm. that Bono provokes, and just like the music. And so I liked them at that era, you know,
So I do think now, for myself, looking back, I'm going, they were fantastic records. But at the time, I'm going, that's overblown.
See, I always remember my pal, Stephen Ball, who was the guy who had been staying at his house the night before, and he'd got an acoustic guitar for his 17th. It was Christmas, and he was about 17, and Sunday Bloody Sunday was one of the first songs that he learned to play. So when we'd ever have a party, then he would always play that. And I was always in awe of him, just being able to just, you know, a song that you'd heard in the record, and then he starts playing it in the guitar, and we all start singing it, so I've got fond memories of that as well. You're not convinced, I can tell.
No, I'm a big U2 fan, but it took me years to appreciate 1980s U2. I was a bit like yourself. Adtone Baby was the first record, mm-hmm. then Zuropa, straight after that.
Yeah.
And I went to see them in Murrayfield, 94 it would have been.
Right.
The Pop Mart tour. I went to see
that's when it became quite overblown, eh?
Mm-hmm.
My first gig I ever went to, Paul, was Celtic Park U2, 1993. They were just about to pull the seats out of put the seats into the jungle, sorry, aye. And we seen U2, and they were supported by Stereo AMCs and Utah Saints. And that was the Act Two and Baby, that was Zoo TV. So I've got good memories of U2 for a wee bit later.
So, Paul, I think you're going to jump 10 years here.
Yes.
And what's your fourth game and your fourth choice of music?
Would you say jumping forward 10 years? And again, I think it's one probably everybody that was alive at the time will choose the day we stopped the 10. And I think with every passing year, that is arguably the most important title in our history. Certainly up there, you know, maybe with the first title, or in terms of significance, because I think we can all sit now and think back to then. The prospect of having not won the title that year is actually too horrific to comprehend. Regardless of what's gone on since, I think just the fact that we'd have had to live with the fact that we hadn't stopped the 10, and then if we hadn't stopped the 10, could we have stopped the 11? Or, you know, because they obviously, we didn't win the title for a couple of years after that. So the importance of that game and that season is just, I don't think it can ever be underestimated. So I think it has to be up there in the club's history as one of the biggest title wins. I mean, you think we changed manager at the start of that season and brought in some new players and didn't have the best start. And, you know, it's always, you know, people I think said at the time and even subsequently that it was almost as if neither side wanted to kind of take the initiative and actually win the title. But I don't think I've ever, I've rarely felt more nervous at a game than I was that day, I think, because of what it meant. And I think it was more relief than anything else at the final whistle.
Definitely. I don't think I enjoyed that day. Even looking back on it now, sometimes you look back on things and go, that was fantastic. When I look back on that day, I think there was too much at stake for me to genuinely say that was a fantastic day. It was a fantastic couple of days after it, but that day, the relief was mere, as you say, it was like a massive weight getting lifted off you.
Because I still don't think MD, everybody knew what it was at stake, but what was at stake, but I still don't think MD could quite appreciate if we hadn't won what it was.
I know.
It just was beyond comprehension. So you knew, and then given what happened the week before, it was just a horrible week leading up to the actual game itself. And, you know, even after scoring an early goal, I don't think MD relaxed. You know, it really was only in the final whistle that he suddenly thought. And then it's kind of weird that it's like, you know, I would have grown up, you know, as a wee boy, just at the tail end of the 9-0 era, and then we were winning titles in the late 70s, early 80s, and then the centenary. But then even after the centenary season, nobody would have thought we'd have gone 10 years without winning another title. That was just, nobody would have comprehended that. So there were people who wouldn't have remembered us winning a title that day.
The only disappointment really was the fact that quite quickly we realised there was going to be some more upheaval with the departure of Wim Jansen. But if you study that season and you look at the departures in the pre-season, top goal scorer George Cadet, he's away. Paolo Di Canio left. McStay retired. A couple of weeks into the new season, Grant was away. So you had the mainstays gone. And I think some of the signings that came in, you know, Darren Jackson, I didn't think I was convinced when he came in. Larson we knew about, but we didn't really know what he would become. And I just think we had no right to win the league that season. But the one moment of the season where it seemed as though we were going to grab that initiative, I felt, was the New Year's Day game, you know, the 2-0 game. But even then, there was a few wee issues and you know, losing games, particularly to Rangers. But that 2-0 victory, Wim Janssen's only victory against Rangers, the New Year's Day game. I think that was the real turning point.
I remember going on the supporters bus after we won it the New Year. I was convinced we were winning the treble. I was utterly convinced that we were going to go on and win everything. That was maybe Mary Day with a Buckfast I was drinking at that point, right enough. But, and I remember being, we lost to Rangers at Celtic Park in the semi-final, 1-0, Coy scored a diving header. And I think I remember a story by Mark Weeper actually saying, as the ball came across, McCoist was laughing because he knew he was getting there in front of Reaper.
We got the last laugh, Kevin.
I know we did.
Absolutely.
You know, the other thing that I found quite interesting speaking to the likes of Tom Boyd, Simon Donnelly about that season was, and Jock Brown actually, there was a stipulation that when they were replacing Tommy Burns, that it had to be a non-British manager. And I asked Jock Brown for the reasoning behind that. It was obviously Fergus McCann's decision, because the one guy that they were interested in and who was interested in the job, believe it or not, was Bobby Robson, who at that point was at Barcelona.
It's a case of what might have been, eh?
I know. But there was a stipulation, and Jock Brown believes it was the emotional attachment to the job and the fact that you had to remove that and just get somebody in who could just do the job rather than everything else that goes with it.
Yeah, it's a hell of a gamble. I mean, that when you talk about that, the game we won at New Year, I mean, I think, I always think Paul Lambert sometimes is, I mean, I thought he was a for me, he was a world-class midfielder. But I think, you know, obviously because other players maybe scored more goals and made more headlines, I thought he was a key figure for us. He was for even that season. But in that period, I think, you know, when you, I always think it's strange that he went away to Germany. It's just an okay player. Nobody would have batted an eyelid about him, but I think he came back as a world-class midfielder. I always think even now, whether it's Scottish players or English players, I think more of them would benefit of going and playing abroad in a better quality of football, not competitive, but just better quality. And I think Lambert's a perfect example of what can happen to you when you come back, because I thought he was instrumental for us.
It's learning a different mindset. Different intelligence, just learning different things from obviously countries that are now developing players far better than what Scotland can do. I was really quite pleased that Ryan Gold went to Portugal. I don't know if it's quite working out for him across there, but that was an interesting move at times. But you have a look at the young Scottish players now, they just seem to see going down to England. That's where they want to go.
I mean, obviously, that attracts them. The money attracts them. And obviously, there is a real hype about the best league in the world. Maybe it is the most competitive. But in terms of actual, you know, learning to love the ball and learning to know what to do with it, I think, you know, if Liam Henderson stays out in Italy, for example, I think he'll come back, you know, a much better player, because the kind of football and, you know, he's obviously a player of real ability. So he's obviously been able to thrive in that environment. And I think, you know, at a national level, you saw it in the World Cup. Ultimately, what undid England was the fact that they just reverted to type. Because they didn't have anybody in the middle of the park that can actually hold the ball the way somebody like Modric can. Modric was a really good player at Spurs, but he became a world-class player when he went and played in Spain because of the type of football. Mm-hmm. So as I say, I think Lambert going there and learning those sort of things and about how important it is to hold on to the ball and keep the ball really benefited us.
I'm slightly surprised that Henderson never took the opportunity to go to Sierra A. He stayed with Hellas Verona's and Sierra B, which I find a bit surprising because he did have offers, well, reported offers for Parma and Fiorentina.
I think he'll get there. Mm-hmm. You know, I think if they were interested before, after a, you know, a season, I think he'll get there.
What about his brother Ewan? Do you see a future for him?
Yeah, I mean, he's certainly. I think what's really interesting is that he was one of the young guys that went away with first team in pre-season, and he was one of the ones that they've obviously liked the look of him from the last year or two. And since he's come back, and you know, the it was a really young team, beat Manchester United over in Coleraine, and he was outstanding. And I think he's certainly got a chance. And I think what they do is almost like, you know, give these young guys a taste of what it's like. So they're maybe going away in pre-season training, or they're training with the first team up at Lennox Town, and it's to see. Obviously, if they've got the ability to push on, but also to give them that incentive, because they obviously want to be playing there and training with these guys every day. And certainly he's one of the number ones who has a real chance, I think.
Now, 1998, Kevin, I don't know about yourself, but that was a great time for music for me. So I'm looking forward to seeing what track you choose from that era.
Well, this was a really difficult one. And the reason I chose is Oasis Wonderwall. And part of the reason for that was I kind of missed... when Oasis first broke out onto the scene, there was a kind of period from... I got married in 1991, so there was a period of about 4 or 5 years after I got married, and the kids were all... And we have got 3 kids, so they were all just really young. So, effectively, popular culture just didn't exist for me. You know, it was like whatever cartoons or anything was on the TV. So I missed that whole... The kind of explosion of Britpop and Oasis in particular. And the reason I love Wonderwall is, I think that was the song I must have heard it on the radio, and it was just one of those moments where you think, you know, occasionally when you hear a song and you go, what on earth is that? And it's just, I thought it was absolutely brilliant. And then that's what got me back into Oasis, and then realised that, well, I had all these babies in the house, that other things had been going on. And it was also the song that my sister, when I was 21, my sister had bought me an acoustic guitar for my birthday, and I had a few half-hearted attempts to learn it, and my pal would put it into tune for me and tried to show me how to tune it by ear, and I just was too lazy, I think, to take that up. So every time I knocked it out of tune, it just went into the cupboard. But then after I heard Wonderwall, I thought, I want to learn to play that. And so I got the guitar out and I'd bought a wee electronic tuner, so I knew when I was learning, if the guitar sounded terrible, it was because I wasn't playing the chords right. If the guitar was in tune, then it was me, so that was a way of learning. And it was always with a name eventually of being able to play Wonderwall. So I absolutely love that song. So their version's better than mine, I have to say, but I do like playing it at parties.
It's the song that changed indie guitar music forever. It was the one that kind of smashed independent music over the barricades into the mainstream. a crossover for me that will never be repeated. Any other British guitar band now can only strive to do what Oasis did, and they won't do it anymore. We're too fractured, we're too split. Everybody's got their own wee tribe now. And
but I think that can always... I mean, music's always had tribes, but then sometimes something brings it all together. You know, it's like I listen to a lot of absolute 80s mm-hmm. radio, and then sometimes a song will come on that at the time back when it was out, sometimes for totally random reasons I didn't like it, and I've no idea why, but then I listen to it and I go, that was actually quite good. Although every time I hear Wet or Queen, I go, they were rubbish then and they're still rubbish. But I think sometimes there is, you know, music will come along and it'll unite. What I thought was interesting, I remember listening to, I think Noel Gallagher did, I'm not sure, it might even have been something as random as Desert Island Discs, but he was talking about how a million and one bands and obviously a million and one people like me picked up the guitar, I think, on the back of Oasis, relatively simple songs that you could learn the basic chords mm-hmm. and get a sing-song going. And that, I think that's his frustration, saying, well, who's going to do that for the next... Who's inspiring the next generation to come through? And he didn't see who's doing that at the moment. I still think there's probably some band or some group of young kids have got together at school and are just practising in their bedroom in 5 years' time. They could be the next thing.
Hopefully,
you know, I think that's the nature of music. I'm sure mm-hmm. at various times people have said, you know, maybe just before yeah. punk, for example, mm-hmm. everybody was saying... Things are pretty grim. Suddenly there's an explosion and then loads of things come out of that. So
mm-hmm. it prompts the reaction.
I'm optimistic.
Today is gonna be the day that they're gonna throw it back to you. By now you should have somehow realized what you gotta do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. Backbeat, the word is on the street that the fire in your heart is out. I'm sure you've heard it all before, but you never really had a doubt. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. And all the roads we have to walk are winding, and all the lights that lead us there are blinding. Not to do. I don't believe that anybody feels the way I do about you now. And all the roads that lead you there were winding, and all the lights that light the way are blinding. There are many things that I would like to say to you, but I don't know how. I said maybe
That was Oasis at the peak of their powers, as selected by author and Celtic View editor Paul Cuddihy. Paul has chosen the soundtrack to his Celtic life, and we're just over halfway through his selections. The remaining tracks will be included in part 2 very soon, so keep checking back and subscribe to our award-winning show through your podcast player. Paul's colleague Tony Hamilton was also recently a very special guest of A Celtic State of Mind, and the Celtic FC Foundation are currently putting together one of their much-anticipated charity matches at Celtic Park. A Match for Cancer is a fantastic fundraising event which will take place on the 8th of September 2018 at 2 p.m. Ex-Celt Stylian Petrov and current Liverpool midfielder James Milner are pulling together opposing squads from the worlds of football and entertainment for what is sure to be another unforgettable day. James Milner's squad will be managed by current Liverpool manager Jurgen Klopp and will include such players as Jason McAteer, Jamie Redknapp, Emil Heskey, Dirk Kuyt and Peter Crouch. Stan's team will be managed by our very own Brendan Rodgers, and captain Scott Brown will be part of that squad alongside legends Henrik Larsson, Lubo Maravcik, Paddy McCourt, Arthur Boric, John Hartson, Tosh McKinley, Jackie McNamara, Simon Donnelly, Robbie Keane and Haristo Stoichkov. Now, as we all know, Stylian has bravely battled through leukemia since being diagnosed in 2012, and every penny raised from this game will be split between the foundations of Stan, Celtic and James Milner. Celtic FC Foundation has confirmed that the first two cancer charities it will work with to make a positive difference to patients and their families are Glasgow Children's Hospital Charity and Beatson Cancer Charity. Tickets for A Match for Cancer are now on general sale from the ticket office and also online. They're priced at £14 for adults and just £6 for concessions. Some of those excerpts have featured in the soundtrack of Paul Cuddihy's Celtic Life, and part 2 of this episode will be available soon. So be sure to return to hear Paul with A Celtic State of Mind.